Hi there, this is Marty Otañez, the producer of Getting High on Anthropology. Today we have a special guest in Stuttgart, Germany, Sebastián Marincolo. Welcome to the show, Sebastián. Why don't you tell us your title and the kind of work that you do?
I am a philosopher, have a PhD in philosophy, I'm specialized on the philosophy of mind. And I have written 3 books on the cannabis high and its positive potential. I'm working on my 4th now. And I have written an expert blog for Sensi Seeds in Amsterdam on the same subject, and produced a limited art series of cannabis macro art photos. And am now working on my 4th book, which is gonna be titled How to Get High, where I teach people how to use cannabis for various mind enhancements.
There is a lot to talk about, especially this idea of mind-enhancing potential of cannabis. So before we dive into it, can you take us back before you started the PhD and give us a story about that one moment when you realized that this area for you was really rich and you wanted to sort of cross that line? Like, was there one representative moment that was pivotal in your decision to go down this track?
I can give you one moment where I was actually looking back on my first really high experience, which was when I got high in Kenya. I was in my early 20s and I got high there. It's a long, funny story, actually, because I smoked 3 times. I never got high there. And then in the end, I went to a guy at a hotel at the reception desk, a young guy, young Kenyan guy, and I said, I tried here and I think Kenyan grass may not be so strong. Maybe I don't get high. And he was like, the proud stoner type. He was like, what? You come with me. He was like, what? You were saying that about Kenyan grass? Anyway, I got really high and I was still high. That was like 4 hours before I had to go to the airport. So I went there. I'm not going to go through the whole story, but I ended up high, flying high. And I remember how we took off in the plane and how I had this feeling. I mean, I had been on planes for a long time, and that was like my, I don't know, 50th trip or so on an airplane. But I had this feeling of this blessing of looking down on villages and on streets and on life in general, and being able to sit in this wonderful thing constructed by engineers with a million pieces, and being able to be lifted up there. So I had this awe, this feeling of awe and happiness going up there and looking down on my life. And I later, when I got high later, years later, I thought about that episode and I thought, this is actually what, to me, what the high means. It's because very often when you're high, you're seeing new patterns in your life. You understand patterns in which, your wife has been reacting to you. You understand patterns about how you've been defensive about things. You understand patterns as if you would look on something from above, and see new patterns, how cars drive through circles and how houses are built and how people live together. So it's like gaining a new perspective. You're high up and you're looking down and you see new patterns and you have that feeling of euphoria. And I think, I mean, that Kenyan experience was one of my first highs, but that was, I think that was a hook for me. And then later to look at it and to revisit that feeling, I'd say this is for me actually the meaning of getting high. It's not just euphoria. It's really the euphoric feeling of gaining new insights and seeing new patterns in your life and on all levels, in art and music and the behavior of people that for me made it.
So let's talk about the most recent book you wrote. What's the title? And I understand you go through a number of prominent figures. Is there one in particular, a prominent figure that has used cannabis that you want to talk about, and why that one is special to you?
I mean, the book is titled What Hashish Did to Walter Benjamin. And so let's talk about Walter Benjamin. He's not, he's pretty popular when you study art. He was actually a German philosopher who didn't get his dissertation because he was always in between literature and philosophy, and he was basically a genius. But he started, he translated, he also worked as a translator, he translated Baudelaire, and Baudelaire and the French Club des Assassins. It was a hashish club in 1840 with like the cultural and literature elite in Paris forming a club where they started to experiment with hashish. Walter Benjamin said, he translated that and said, okay, we have to repeat that experiment to use hashish for for creativity and to get inspiration for our writing and to see if that works or not. So he did that, and actually in the Weimar Republic, like Germany in the 20s, drug research was pretty strong. Cocaine had just been produced by German companies and came on the market, and the First World War was over, so a lot of people were addicted to morphine and other substances. There were addiction clinics. There was a lot of research in Germany at that time, and he was part of that research effort in a way, because he had two doctors friends who helped him to sit down, and he was really honestly sitting down to philosophical, what he called profane illumination, to get insights on marijuana or on hashish. And he wrote protocols, and we have some protocols. They are in a book called On Hashish by him. And it's interesting to see that he actually, a lot of people who look at his writing say, oh, he didn't really get to where he wanted to go because it's a bit complicated to decipher. He's not an easy writer. But on the basis of my research of the cognitive enhancements, I mean, I've been researching that now for 13 years. I've looked through his writings, and I think I can actually walk you through a bit better how he, and you can see it in his writings, that he came to really great ideas. He wrote excellent, he had excellent observations about the cannabis high itself, what it does to your imagination, to your pattern recognition, to your empathic understanding. And he came up with great ideas for his later writing. And just to finish that off, his most influential essay is on how art changed in the age of mechanical reproduction. So he said that in the 20th century, when photography started and when film started, so media were, you know, a piece of art could be reproduced, art changed its meaning, and it changed it completely changed the way we look at art and how the meaning of art evolved. And he had great ideas for that while he was high. And so for me, in that book, it was important to show not only how the high can actually influence your mind and give you ideas, or, you know, come so that you as a person come to various enhancements, but I also wanted to show what kind of influence that already had through thinkers like Benjamin on society. So this book, my new book, What Hashish Did to Walter Benjamin, is a collection of essays. I started writing them for Expert Blog for Sensory Seeds, and then I expanded them a little and researched deeper to make a book out of them. And so it's different from what I've done before in a way, because I introduce a lot of the individual cognitive enhancements, you know, pattern recognition and introspection, all functions that can better individually for people. But I try to look also what traces it left. And Louis Armstrong, for instance, is one case in point where you can see that I have one essay in my book, which is on the early evolution of jazz. And this is unthinkable without marijuana. And I try to actually, because everybody kind of knows that marijuana, that jazz musicians were taking marijuana and using marijuana, like Armstrong or Billie Holiday or Dizzy Gillespie or others. But it's not quite clear how much it helped them. And if you look at the whole story of the early evolution of jazz, it's just amazing to see what cannabis did to the whole scene. I give you just two little stories. Like, one is, for instance, that we know now from California and other states that medical cannabis can help a lot of post-traumatic syndrome patients, and it helps amazingly well. So at that time in the 20s, you know that most of the black citizens of the United States in the South were completely traumatized. You know, they were not, in some places, they were not allowed to step on the shadow of a white guy. They were, you had the Jim Crow laws, you had lynchings. So most of them were completely traumatized. And then they come up with swing music, you know. So cannabis helped them. That was one influence, I'm pretty sure, you know, that it helped them to actually, with their grief and with their traumas, to get over that. And then, but then I also wanted to know, well, did it only help in this way, or did actually performers like Billie Holiday go on stage to perform while they were high? And Billie Holiday, I looked at some biographies, and you know, there's a story about her that she would go backstage to smoke a joint to go back on stage, and when it was then it became forbidden, she would take a cab and drive around the block just to smoke one or two joints and to come back and go on stage. So yeah, they did go on stage, like Armstrong and others. And of course, on the basis of my research on the enhancements, I can be a bit more precise on what I think, how cannabis influenced people like Louis Armstrong, and through them, society as a whole. And it had a huge positive impact. I mean, cannabis, through jazz, through the pop music, whatever happened in the 60s, and whatever, a lot of intellectuals and philosophers and scientists and artists who used it, gave great impulses to society. And I think we're only able to evaluate that better once we understand how cannabis can actually help us to come to ideas and to gain new perspectives.
You know, the way you are presenting your work, it is considered research, and you introduce this idea of Guinea. So talk about this approach to research, and what one or two recommendations would you have for others who want to pick up and move forward with the foundation you've already constructed?
Guinea means what I called it, the approach. My research approach is a guerrilla neurophilosophical approach. Guerrilla means that you actually, guerrilla because you actually have to look into some sources. You learn from an illegal market, you learn from people who are illegally smoking marijuana, from their experiences, from their reports. But also, if you look into the breeder scene, you know, if you want to know something about the marijuana that they use, you know, you have to know something about the strains. So you have to know something about, you know, how they were bred and what are the influences on that black market. You know, how was the evolution in the last 30, 40 years? You know, what is skunk? Is there one skunk? What is haze? So there is a part in it of that research where you actually have to step into and look into areas where normally scientists are like, you know, that's not allowed, and look into some of that. And but the neurophilosophical approach means that I'm looking at effects of cannabis and of the potential of cannabis on mental abilities like introspection and or empathic understanding or pattern recognition. And these are, you know, if you look at these alone, independently of the cannabis thing, it's an interdisciplinary project. You know, you have some neurobiologists who come up with some theories about how they think empathy might work. You have cognitive psychologists in there. You have evolutionary biologists in there. You have computer program scientists who say we have models of how the brain might work. So this is a huge interdisciplinary field that, you know, I'd call like neurophilosophical, because it's neuroscientists, philosophers who are trying to evaluate things and DJ the whole thing. So I've tried to look at a lot of anecdotal evidence, and I need to really show why I did that. In the 70s, in the early or late 60s, early 70s, Lester Greenspoon, Harvard professor for psychiatry, emeritus now, he's 88 or 89 already. I just got off the phone with him, we're good friends. He started to look into into stories from people and collect stories from stoners. And at the same time, Charles Tart, a psychology professor at Harvard, started to send out questionnaires to people who would smoke marijuana. Why? The insight was to say that all the research that's out there, the studies, the clinical studies, there were few and you weren't allowed to do them really, were bullshit. Most of them also because people, you set them in an environment where they're anxious, they're observed by people, they sit in a clinical environment, so the set and setting, as we say, is wrong. So whatever you get out of that is not really their reactions to a drug, but their reactions to the environment and to the situation. And so you better go, if you really want to know how cannabis works on people, you better go and ask the people who are used to it, you get to know, you know, who know how to use it, you know how to dose it, etc. So this is basically, in a nutshell, to wrap that up, my approach was to go from, to take up that research, to look into hundreds, but seriously hundreds of anecdotal reports, trying to critically evaluate them, because there's bullshit in there. There's a lot of, you know, bullshit in there. But so you look, if that, is that independent, or did he copy that from somebody else, what he was reporting, or is he influenced by his religion, or he says he has religious epiphanies or whatever. So you have to really critically evaluate, but then see if you come to an understanding of how the cognitive enhancements, how, in what detail do they explain those. And then you look into the theories, into the neurophilosophical theories. What do we know about introspection? How does it work? What do we know about empathic understanding? And of course, what do we know about the endocannabinoid system and those studies? And then you come to try to put the puzzle pieces together and see how, if you find how cannabis actually systematically affects higher cognitive processes like pattern recognition, etc.
Did you actually talk to stoners, so users of cannabis, and what's one kind of conversation that you found really interesting or useful for you to understand, you know, some of these potential uses, mind-enhancing uses of cannabis?
You know, I have so many personal conversations with my friends, and of course I forgot my own approach, which also already for many makes me, you know, is bad for me, for my scientific reputation. I, of course, said I'm a psychonaut. I'm you know, I'm smoking myself, or no, I'm not smoking, actually I'm vaporizing, and I have good reasons for that. I don't know if I want to go into that, but of course I'm going off my own experiences, but I have to of course see them as one puzzle piece in the whole thing, you know. Yeah, from a conversation, I give you one example which I found absolutely fascinating. I wrote an essay about cannabis empathy and autism, severe cases of autism, and where I basically describe my research from, because I know a lot about theories of empathy, and that was one of my special fields, like to see how, I'm always talking about while you're high, I'm not talking about long-term effects, I'm always talking about the short-term effects. And I looked into how normal people, and we have a lot of reports about that, and I have experienced it myself, how they feel like they are better in empathically understanding other people while they're high. So they smoke a joint, or they vaporize, or they eat something, and they feel like, oh, I'm telepathically connected to the other person. I know where he comes from now, and I suddenly understand how he ticks or feels, etc. So I worked a lot on that, and I wrote an essay about not only about how it helps usual people, but also about how it seems to help autistic children. And there were a lot of cases. There are a lot of cases in the States, and I had a feedback to that essay from a student, 20-year-old student, who said that he was, I think, of Saudi Arabian parents. He's in New York, can't give more specifics, but he said that he was traumatized in his childhood. He didn't go into the details, but he said he never felt connected to people. And he actually thought, he had the feeling, the basic feeling that he's alone in the world. And that's the words he used. Everybody else is just an extension of his ego. That's really how he felt. And he said to me, when he started to, when he smoked marijuana for the first time, when he was, I think, 16, he, for the first time in his life, felt that he's connected, that there are other people out there, that he's not alone. And he said to me, in the, we had a long conversation, and he said to me that he actually, when he's not taking marijuana, like, I'm not sure, daily or, you know, once in a while, this feeling goes away. He feels like he's not connected. He remembers from his, he knows now that there are other people, but it's becoming more of a theoretical knowledge to him, because on a daily basis, he feels like disconnected when he doesn't have cannabis. So this is, there is really feedback coming. And I had similar feedback from an Asperger's patient who also told me that it helps him to connect on a fundamental level, and that he couldn't function. I actually had it from various Asperger's patients that, who said that they couldn't function on a daily level in a relationship. They couldn't have a relationship, for instance, without cannabis. So there's really interesting personal feedback there. And a lot of people think, for instance, they think empathy is sympathy, that when I'm empathic to somebody, I, you know, I like him, or it means that we're getting closer or something. That's not really what I mean. Technically, empathic understanding is your ability to understand how other people, to be able to explain, predict, and understand the behavior of other people. So you, on a very basic level, you see a guy throwing a stone at somebody else's head. The guy turns around, runs towards him, and he kicks him, or, you know. And you can explain that behavior. You're like, okay, he thinks that he threw that stone at his head, so he's angry, and therefore he runs back. You can predict our behavior to a certain degree. You know, you're married, and then you're like, you don't get the trash out or something as you're supposed to do. And to some level, after 10 years, you know how your wife is going to react to that, you know, or if you forget her birthday or something, you're going to be like, oh, you know, she's not going to say anything, but she's going to be really sad. And I think I should. So it's our empathic understanding, is our ability to get into the shoes of others, to understand them, to understand how they feel, how they react on a daily level. And of course, some of us are really good at it. Some of us are really bad.
What is that phrase, cognitive function, and what's the link between cannabis use from your research?
Cognitive function, you could replace that with mental function, or with, you know, being able to, you know, thinking abilities. For instance, one cognitive function would be your ability to remember episodes in your life. There's a special term for that, which is episodic memory. It's a special capacity we have, ability we have. We always, very, very often, people concentrate on the short-term memory problems you get while you're high. So especially when you smoke bad grass or old grass with a lot of CBN, you have that short-term memory problem where you're in the middle of saying something and then you're losing the thread. You're like, what did I just say? So that happens. We know that that can happen. There are ways, and actually I'm teaching how to, you can actually reduce that where if you're using a vaporizer, et cetera, et cetera. I'm not going to go into that now. But what we're not talking a lot about is the enhancement of episodic memory retrieval during a high. Sounds complicated. It's very easy. Is you get high and suddenly you remember an episode in your life, maybe your 10th birthday, which is maybe 30 whatever years away, and you suddenly remember how the cake looked, how it tasted to you, how proud you felt to for the first time get this chocolate cake that is a special celebration for your 10th birthday, how you had a girl standing invited at your party who had a crush on you and you felt embarrassed, you know, at that age. You remember the episode in your life in details that are unimaginable, you know, before, were unimaginable before, and now you're high and you're going through those details in your memory, which are amazing. And that has been reported by so many people that they had those flashbacks, so to say, that they had those memories, long-term memories. So this is one cognitive effect. Another one would be pattern recognition. pattern recognition, your ability to see patterns, or to, it's not only seeing, it's also hearing, to be like, oh, you hear a Miles Davis solo and you hear it and you see it, or you hear a pattern in it and you can see, oh, I can see the influence of Charlie Parker in there. You know, this is pattern recognition. Or you see somebody walking down the street and he walks like this with his shoulders hanging, and you see a pattern in the walking style, and you know, empathic understanding again, but this is pattern recognition. You see, oh, this guy is sad or depressed, or, you know, that's a pattern. It's a behavioral pattern. Or you see a behavioral pattern in somebody playing chess while you're playing chess, and you understand, oh, he's always starting aggressively and then starting to, and then he switches to defend himself or something like that. That's also a pattern. Imagination, another cognitive ability we have, to imagine something, to keep something in your mind. And again, it's not only visual. You know, you can imagine an image, an elephant dancing on the roof or something, but you can also imagine a melody, which, for instance, helps somebody who wants to compose music. They sit down, they get high, and then they can actually imagine how a certain instrument, a harp, would sound with an orchestra behind, and then a trumpet, you know. So they have that ability to have that in their heads, to imagine that. So all these are imagination, episodic memory, or memory in general, pattern recognition, empathic understanding, introspection, your ability to reflect on yourself and to gain insights about yourself, your ability to perceive your body. I would include that here. These are all cognitive functions, and some of them get magnificently enhanced during high. And that's something very useful, of course.
Could you paint a picture about maybe any upcoming writings that you're working on, and what could be, give us a teaser of what to expect?
Easiest way to look into my books and research and articles is to go to my blog, marijuana-insights.com. Marijuana with J, or just look for Sebastian Marincolo in Google, and you know, you have all the books there, and I have a blog with, and there's my photography is there too, and my cannabis art photography, my macro art, and my books described. My next book is already done. I'm still working on the illustrations, and the title will be How to Get High. I believe that, because I want to say two things to finish that up, what I said before about the enhancements. There is no total enhancement of cognition or of your mind. You know that from whatever drugs, like for instance, cannabis, for instance, focuses you really well. You hyper-focus on something. That's one of the basic things cannabis can do. But that means, of course, when you're hyper-focused on an activity, you see more details in that activity. You're probably getting better. You're eating something. You can actually discriminate a lot more flavors, or you're working concentrated on a text on something, and you elaborate on that. But then, of course, you lose something in the periphery of your vision because you're concentrated. So cannabis enhances various, but it changes your total cognition to a degree where you have to know how to use it. Because if you're using it in the wrong environment, if you're driving, for instance, and you're too hyper-focused, or you're imagining things and you don't pay attention anymore, it's actually quite dangerous and really bad. So you have to be able to integrate that altered state of mind into your life to profit from it, you can only profit, for instance, from enhanced imagination, which you, by the way, also have when you're sleeping. You know, you can imagine, you see pictures, but you don't profit from sleeping when you're driving. Just, you know, it's a very simple lesson. And you don't profit from a high when you're on the road, when you're really too high. So my new book, because of that, and I think that my basic metaphor is for I'm talking about not the effects, but the potential of a cannabis high, because I think you have to learn to ride a high like you have to learn how to ride a surfboard. It's a great, cannabis is a great tool to have those enhancements. But if you don't know the dosage that is good for you, the situation when it's good for you, you have to be in the right mood to take it. You have to be with the right people. You know, sometimes you're getting high and you're with the wrong people. It's going to totally ruin your high, your experience. So you really have to learn how to get high, under what conditions, and how to use it for various activities. Some people may want to use it to get rid of their pain. Some people may want to use it to de-stress and just, you know, have fun sitting in nature. Some people want to create, want to play music. So, and you have to learn for each of that. You have to get into and see which strain is good for me, which dosage is good for me, which method of intake is good, which environment is good for me. When is it good in the evening? Is it good in the morning? And so my new book, How to Get High, is actually there to teach people how to use cannabis, to use it for those cognitive enhancements, to get better, to be able to remember things from the past, to sit down. And I give little exercises. It's a very minimalist book. It's going to be a small postcard format book to give to your friend, or, you know, to people where, you know, or for yourself when you know, oh, I want to make more of cannabis. You know, I don't want to just sit down, because I think a lot of people use it for escapism, what mm-hmm. I would call escapism. And you can get really bad grass with a lot of CBN, with cannabinol, which makes you tired and dizzy. So you, if you do that, you can sit down and it kind of cripples you mentally. Like, you know, some people would just use a lot of bad alcohol to cripple them mentally. And then you sit down, and what it does for you is then you forget about the world, and you can sit down and just play a computer game or something. And it helps you with your stress. But in the long run, if you always keep on using it only for escapism, it might have really bad effects on your life, because you don't learn to deal with your problem, but you learn to run away from them. So I want to get people out of that. And I think a lot of users are using it or abusing it like that. It really is a really important point to make. There's a lot of abuse, but there's also a lot of use.
So how would you talk to me in terms of advice to use this product, cannabis, to use it well and to get the most mileage out of it above and beyond just abusing it for escapism, as you said earlier?
First, before you use it, get informed. Read my book, of course, my new book. You know, inform yourself a bit, especially about the dosage. Some things I would tell you, for instance, as you know, one trap that a lot of people go into is that they smoke for the first time, they have no effect at all. Smoke for the second time, no effect at all. Third time, no effect at all. It's something we know that happens to about, I don't know, it's not clear, 40, 50, 60% of all of us. You know, when you talk to people, they say, no, the first time's no effect. There are studies now that hint to the direction that it might be that for some people, the endocannabinoid system needs to be triggered first to build some receptors. So for instance, what I tell people, let's say you want to try a vaporizer or a joint for the first time. You smoke three times. Your friends tell you, you know, try, take three puffs and then leave it. So you do that, nothing happens. A week later, you do that, nothing happens. And you do that again, nothing happens. So you're like, okay, I need to up the dosage. And then you're smoking two joints, and then but then your system is there. And then of course you're completely gone, you know? So I tell people, don't up the dosage in the, like, wait a few times until you tried. So first, really the dosage is important. Try, stay low for the beginning. What is also important is the feedback. Don't eat cannabis when you're not experienced. Why? Because it takes 1 to 3 to 2.5 hours or so to take effect. It goes through your stomach. It's metabolized to 11-hydroxy-THC, which is stronger. And so it's really hard to get the dosage right. Also for the people who are making the cookies, you know, sometimes they say, yeah, that cookie I used whatever gram and should be okay. When you're overdosing on it, because the heating, and there are a lot of variables in the process that are hard to control. So edibles are great if you know what you're doing and if you're used to it and you have some knowledge, but don't do edibles in the beginning. I'd really recommend try something like a vaporizer, something where you have a quick feedback. A vaporizer is something, also people make a mistake. vaporizer for me is a much clearer, better high than if you burn the material in a bong or in a joint. And I actually wrote an essay about that, but it takes 10 to 15 minutes to take the full effect. So if you vaporize after, you know, people who are used to joints or to a bong or so, they get hit almost instantly. It's like within 30 seconds, they know where they are with their eye. They're like, okay, I need to pass that on now. You know? So that's enough for 5 minutes until that comes around. With a vaporizer, a lot of people inhale, and they're like, okay, nothing's happening. 5 minutes, 10 minutes have passed. So I inhale more and then they overdose and it's not killing their brain or something, but you know, they might end up with panic or not being able to remember where they have to go, etc. So that is, dosage is really important. And then just one more thing for now, you should get to know what you should get informed about the material that you're getting. In the States, many people now have the privilege that they can actually get good strains and they know where the material comes from in a dispensary. So try to know as much as you can about the material you get and ask those people what it does. Does it affect your body more? Because there's a huge range how cannabis can affect you. Some strains are more uplifting, bring you more euphoria, happiness. Some strains are more like the sativas are more, or the narrow leaf varieties, as we say now, are more on your brain and more on your thinking, whereas other strains might be more affecting your body, you know, relaxing you, etc. You know, get informed about that before you start anything and talk to friends about the dosage. Because seriously, there's a lot of talk about nobody ever died on cannabis, which is true, but you really don't want to overdose. It can get really nasty, really, really nasty. You might go through panic attacks. You might get into really dangerous situations, and it can be quite a traumatizing experience. There's no doubt about that. So, you know, have some respect.
A few minutes ago, you brought up this comparison between a joint and a vaporizing approach. So how is the high different between these two? Could you synthesize that in just a couple sentences?
To understand the difference, you must know that it's, a lot of people think, oh, it's the THC, the delta 9 tetrahydrocannabinol in cannabis, which is the effect, right? No, there are more than 100 cannabinoids in cannabis and more than 200 terpenes, other substances which give you the aroma, but also have a lot of effects on your mind. They can be anxiolytic, so helping to reduce fears or have other effects. And every strain that you get has a different composition, cannabis strain. There are also flavonoids in there, which also have an effect, medical effects, different effects. So it's a huge, we talk now about the ensemble or entourage effect of cannabis, So it's basically a huge cocktail. And now you have to know there's no THC in the plant, really. There's more, it's THCA, it's an acid. So you need to heat it. If you eat a bud, usually nothing's gonna happen. You know, you're not gonna get high. You need to heat it up. You need to bake it, vaporize it, or burn it. Now, when you burn the material, you burn a lot of the cannabinoids and you heat it up to, like, I think in Fahrenheit it would be almost 1,000 degrees when it's burning. When you use a vaporizer, you heat up the cannabis only to I'm always bad with the Fahrenheit conversions. I think it's like 360 degrees to 420 or something degrees in Fahrenheit. And at these temperatures, the cannabinoids start boiling and they evaporate in the air. Now, the important point for you to know is that when you're smoking it, you're burning a lot of stuff, THC, that you don't want to be burned. You actually want to have it in there. And you're changing the whole chemical mix and you're reducing it. You're destroying a lot of the stuff that should still be in there. The taste is not as good. The aroma is not as good, but also the effects are not as good. And you create more CBN. CBN is a degradation product of THC, which makes you more dizzy, tired, makes you forget things more. If you use a vaporizer, you stay more clear because you don't get as much CBN and other substances, also little toxic substances are not in there, like benzene. And you stay more functional. The high is, I think it's also not as much on the body usually, but it's definitely more functional. So in terms of cognitive enhancement, try a vaporizer. I mean, seriously, it's a completely different experience. I think you have to get used to it because it takes longer to take effect, but you're clearer in your mind. You're more functional. You don't have the memory disruptions. And it's a much better, and the aromatic experience, that's one last thing about the vaporizer, I think is very special because it's like a good scotch. When you have a good scotch, you also get a buzz from the alcohol, but the buzz, it opens up your mind because you have a really very complex aromatic experience that, and you're like, oh, there's a little earthy, citrusy, whatever, there's this whole spectrum out there, and with a vaporizer you get that too.
Your work is highly visual and your publications have images and illustrations, so maybe take us to one and your favorite one or the one that's most representative, and you know, I'll put it on screen so people can see it. So what is the image and why does it speak to you?
Let's talk about a really super macro of a trichome field. And I've used, what I tried to do was I wanted to first make people look again. I didn't want to use imagery like, you know, the leaf, because the prototypical imagery, because I wanted to get away and to undercut all the negative associations we have, because there has been disinformation and negative campaigns out for such a long time that when I show you a cannabis leaf, you think of everything but not a plant. You think of criminals, you think of the mark, you think of hippies, whatever, you know, but not, you don't see it anymore as a leaf of a plant, really, you know. So with focusing on the plant and looking at plant parts and giving them a completely new aesthetic, I try to make people look again as a plant, because I think we underestimate cannabis a lot, because we underestimate plants in general, the way plants interact with people, with animals, with their environment, how they use chemicals to manipulate and to seduce and to fend off attackers and herbivores and other things. So we really need to look at cannabis as a plant again if you want to understand it better. My photo of this, of those trichomes, shows very well a technique, two techniques that I used. First is deep field lighting. So I'm going with the light through the plant from behind, which makes, so you see the trichomes on a green leaf, and it looks like something that you would expect for astronauts to find on the moon when they go in a cave and put lighting and they see some crystalline structure. It looks like completely out of this world. And you see those little crystalline mushrooms, which have it their own beauty. And I use deep focus stacking, which is a technology in macro, where you can actually get more depth of vision. So because usually in macro photography, you would only have one small layer in focus and everything else would be blurred. But with this technology, it involves taking 20 photos and then they're fused together, stacked. You can actually see the whole field in focus. So I give it more of a focus, which is also something that you get in high perception. When people are high, people say they perceive things that it looks more crisp. I wanted to actually imitate high perception in my photography. So I used in that photo, you'll see if you look closer, because it's made for, it's art, it's a limited art edition, and it's made for a larger frame. But if you look closer in the black background, you see a little bubbles, and I tried to make it more three-dimensional so that you actually get what a lot of people report when they're high. They say that they feel like they have more depth perception. You know, they feel like the space is getting, they have more of a 3D perception. So I try to incorporate a lot of concepts in that photography to make it a bit psychedelic, to actually give people a high look at a plant. And a plant is a plant is a plant, not a drug.
You know, I have some joy when I hear this metaphor that you bring up about surfing. And could you tell us what the metaphor is and what's the power behind the metaphor? Like, what is the messaging you're trying to get out with that metaphor? Because it's highly visual also.
The metaphor is so easy to understand. And a lot of people, when they hear it, they're like, yeah, you know, I mean, they think, yeah, that's, you know, that's so intuitively easy to grasp. But the implications of that haven't been grasped by a lot of people. I explain that. So the metaphor is cannabis as a surfboard. I started my German book here, my coffee table book with the photography, with an essay about that metaphor, where I said, just imagine you come to a beach on Hawaii in the 50s, and you've never heard about surfing, and there's a guy with flower shorts, whatever, and he, you know, weird hair, and he's standing there with this weirdly shaped board, and he's like, hey, take this, go out with it in the waves, you're gonna have wicked fun. And you're like, yeah, you know, sounds like, and you see those people surfing there, and you're like, yeah, that sounds like a cool idea, I'm gonna do that. You take that surfboard, you go out, and you get hit on the beach three times by large waves, come back with a bleeding nose, and you tell that guy, You're an idiot. You're an asshole. This is not a good tool. You know, this is not, this doesn't have the potential to give me fun experiences. Not at all. I've been there, you know, and of course we know what went wrong. You don't know how to use it. You know, you lack the theoretical knowledge, but you need a lot. You need to learn a lot. You need to learn, am I already, you know, am I prepared with my knowledge to go out with this size or this shape board? Do I need a bigger board to go out in those waves? Same way with cannabis. You need to be able, when you smoke, you need to be able. Some people might be like, when they're beginners, they might be like, oh, when I smoke a joint, I have to be safe inside in my room and with my friends who take care of me, maybe somebody who sits me if I get too tired, if I get too confused or something, who relaxes me, I need some music. And some other more experienced stoners might go like, no, you know, I can smoke a joint and walk and go to a great art exhibition. I find my way around. I know this strain. I know I'm taking three draws. I know where that gets me, and I know what I can do, you know, when I'm that high. So this is basically a very important metaphor to understand how you get, you know, that cannabis has a great potential, but you have to be able to unlock it. And I'm actually giving courses for, if people are interested, in Greenflower Media has a great course for me where I'm actually introducing people, which is a similar project to my book, where I'm giving a presentation of how to unlock those cognitive effects. And there's a newer course out there on how I specifically tell people how to use cannabis for creativity. Let me just add one thing about the implications. Now, for instance, if you go out there and make a poll and ask yourself, is cannabis great for creativity? And you come back and half of the people you ask say, yeah, it worked well for me. And the other half is like, oh no, it completely fucked up my timing when I was on stage. And I wanted to play a solo, but I was too slow, you know, to keep up with others. I couldn't concentrate. And another guy says, no, it actually destroyed my creativity, et cetera, et cetera. Does that mean now that cannabis is like half, it's half and half, so cannabis doesn't, so some people have concluded, so that means cannabis doesn't really do something for you, because it's like, you know, some people it's down, some people it's on. No, that's not what it means. You know, if you'd ask people who, you give surfboards to people, you know, to 100 people, and maybe 30, 40, 50 people have already experiences with surfboards and are sporty guys, you know what they're doing, and the rest of them don't, and they all come, you ask the 100 people, and 50 say, that's bullshit, and 50 say, yeah, that was great. You don't conclude about the surfboard that, you know, it doesn't help at all because it's 50-50. So, you know, it's not a great tool. No, no. You conclude, yeah, it's a great tool for those who know how to use it. And see, this is with cannabis the same thing. No, you don't conclude that because it's 50-50, it's not good for creativity at all. It can be even be bad or something. No, you conclude that, yeah, for some people, it might be great if they know how to use it.
What is the situation of cannabis in Germany? Can you just briefly describe, is it legal or are you hopeful in the future we may see changes in legislation in Germany?
We had medical marijuana for a while now, for some years, but it was only for, you needed as a doctor, you needed a special permission, which was really hard to get. A lot of the doctors still have no clue how much cannabis can do for you. It's used for some pain treatment, and I think some epileptics. I'm really not that knowledgeable about that situation right now, but this will change next year, so doctors will be able to more freely prescribe it. So far, we only had Bedrocan, cannabis from the company. I mean, we had Sativex and Marinol, which are extracts, but which are, or just THC or THC combined with CBD, Sativex. But we know that the natural cannabis is the gold standard. It helps because of what I talked about before, the entourage or ensemble effect. You need all the whole mix. Now you get the whole mix here, but it's only four strains from Bedrocan, or now I think it's five or so. But we're going to have more next year, and the law is going to change on medical cannabis and I think that's going to be also because of the legalization in the States, and because medical, there are more experiences with medical cannabis, because we haven't heard a lot about those stories here about epileptics, how much it helps them, and autism, and how much it helped, because if you had that on the news here, it was hardly on the news, those cases. I think we're going to have a similar thing to what you had in the States, that a lot of people profited from the natural strains, and they had a variety, and a lot of them need a special strain for them and a special mix. That's going to happen in Germany, and that's going to drive a lot of the political debate here, because a lot of people are going to be like, I have an epileptic son, I have a father with Alzheimer's, I have whatever, and I want to try that, and I want access. And I think we're going to have that. As to legalization, it depends on the state you're in. In Berlin, it's pretty liberal. Mm-hmm. Not sure exactly how much you can have, but you can have like a bag full of weed without getting prosecuted. But it's not technically legal. It's still a gray zone. It's decriminalized to a certain degree. So here you don't have to prosecute. In this state here, it's one of the strictest. You can have only like 3 grams or something without being prosecuted. I think that's going to change, but it's going to take a while. I think we're lagging behind the States, maybe more than three years. It's going to be a delayed response, but we're getting there.
Are you hopeful about the future of cannabis research? And if so, or if no, tell us what gives you the source of that hope.
I'm very hopeful, and what will significantly drive our research is not clinical studies at this. I mean, we have a lot of clinical studies on what is happening is the endocannabinoid research, which is, there are, I don't know, thousands of in the last years papers coming out, which is probably the most important homeostatic system in the brain and body to control health and homeostasis, so it keeps your balance for a lot of processes in the body. We have a lot of research out there, and this is gonna get more as scientists have more access. But the research concerning what I'm talking about and medical research is gonna be driven by more people using it, more people getting experiences with an Asperger patient, getting experience with a certain strain, with a certain delivery method, coming back and being like, whoa, that vaporized at that temperature helped me, and it also helped me with my pain. And then you're going to understand better at some point how a certain terpene like myrcene or how alpha-pinene works in combination with CBD, etc. And the more people we have who use cannabis in a controlled way, also with vapor, and I think the vaporizer thing will help a lot, because then we have better data coming back from people who know at which temperature they vaporize the strain, which helps us to understand what actually ended up in their system. You don't know that much about it when you bake it or when you smoke it. And so research is going to explode. We're going to race now, because of course in the States for a long time there were, it was a Schedule A drug, and it was really hard to research that thing. But for my research, as I explained it before, which is also based on a lot of anecdotal evidence and a lot of the feedback from patients and other people, that's going to explode, and it's going to be better, you know, because people are not drawing only on a black market now. They know what they're smoking. They know their strains. They have a better understanding of it. They are going to be like, I tried that high CBD strain and that helped me like this way. And that's going to help us. So, this is going to propel our science in the next few years. That's an absolute exciting time to be in as a scientist, because and that's my last sentence maybe on that one. And as a philosopher, you know, here's my pitch, because I think people in medicine, they understand now that cannabis works so amazingly well because it acts on a system, on a homeostatic endocannabinoid system that's in the brain already, you know, no matter whether you have smoked cannabis or not ever, that takes over so many functions, complicated functions. And I think we are still at the very beginning, and I'm starting, that's where I think my research helps people to get into, is to understand. And I'm pretty sure that the endocannabinoid system is systematically involved in the architecture of higher cognitive functions like pattern recognition, empathic understanding. I think that introspection, our understanding of those processes is not full. We don't have a complete understanding of how we empathically understand other people on the neurological level. You gotta be kidding me. We're far away from understanding. And understanding how cannabis acts on that system will help us to understand the system itself. So this is for neuroscientists who want to get to know more about how the brain works, how our minds work. For cognitive scientists, for philosophers, this is going to propel foundational science on human on the human condition.
A wealth of information, and I feel so fortunate that you were willing to share some of your knowledge. So I want to end here, and I really appreciate the time you gave me and my viewers. And I hope when you do come to Colorado again that we can meet and maybe do a follow-up discussion. So thanks again for your time.
I'm always happy to answer real questions, because for a long time, you know, people, they looked at my research and you always get questions only about legalization. People don't really, they're not really up there. So it's great to have people asking the right questions about that research and see where it goes and what significance it has. And I'm very dependent on that, because for a long time, those people in the movement were not ready for that, because they were like, listen, you know, we're trying to make people understand that it's important medically. Don't give us the full positive potential of the high, because that's too dangerous to talk about. And this is changing now. Seriously, people have the courage. This is just a huge taboo. Even though medical cannabis is not anymore, it's like, yeah, it helps with epilepsy and everything, but it's like, no, the high, that's a side effect, let's not talk about that really, and don't say it has a positive potential, it's like, ooh, that's too esoteric hippie. No, that's hard. I'm talking about hard research, and I'm talking about how that will propel our science of our understanding of consciousness itself. So yeah, I think it's important. Thanks for the questions.